But I would say this is when this prophecy began to be fulfilled in the church dispensation. My doctrine shall drop as the rain that began on Pentecost. Someone said, was that the doctrine dropping as the rain? Most certainly was. He was pouring out his spirit upon all flesh. And the words that he spake to them in that day, they were spirit and they were life. Now, the significance of it is when his doctrine was dropping as rain on Pentecost thereafter, and in the latter rain, as it was poured out in the Azusa Street Mission and continues to be poured out in this day, we must understand along with that was the preaching of the gospel that brought that about. It was the preaching of the gospel, the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ that brought about the fulfillment of this scripture. And contained in the preaching of the gospel is the doctrine of Christ. In the preaching of the gospel, repentance from dead works, which turns us in God's direction, faith toward God, which causes us to believe God. For faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, according to Romans 10:17. And then receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking with other tongues as the Spirit of God gives utterance. That, of course, is the principle of the doctrine of Christ with respect to the laying on of hands. And then, of course, there is the doctrine of baptisms. And that is in the principles of the doctrine of Christ. That's also contained in the gospel with respect to water baptism in Jesus' name. So my doctrine shall drop as the rain. My speech shall distill as the dew. Distill means to purify, to remove all impurities. And this came about through the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is when God accomplished and fulfilled this in his people. The remnant, of course, who received it on the day of Pentecost. Are you listening to me? Those who thereafter came into the church, of course, the Jews and proselytes on the day of Pentecost, the Samaritans 8 years later in the 8th chapter of the book of the Acts of the Apostles when Philip preached to the Samaritans, and of course the Gentiles in the 10th chapter of the book of Acts when Peter preached to Cornelius and his household. His doctrine was dropping as the rain, his speech distilled as the dew, and he poured out the early rain on Pentecost and thereafter. And the latter rain began, as I indicated earlier, in the Azusa Street Mission back around the turn of the century. And that is the turn of the 20th century, around the year 1900 through 1910. Are you listening to me? And so this is much as I will say about that, but to teach the nonsense that you're not going to preach doctrine, well, please, if you're going to say that, please clarify what you're talking about. No, you preach the gospel. Contained in the gospel is the and or are the principles of the doctrine of Christ. These are found in the message of the gospel. But after a person hears and believes and obeys the gospel, then there is a period of time that they are weaned from the breast and drawn from the milk, or however it's said, we're going to read it in a moment. And then they must be instructed or taught out of the doctrine and or the teachings of the apostles. For on the day of Pentecost, after they were water baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, with the evidence of speaking with other tongues, as the Spirit of God gives utterance, as is the like precious experience that we have received among our ranks today, then they gladly received the word, the scripture says, were baptized, and there were 3,000 added to the church, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, the apostles' teaching, in the breaking of bread, fellowship, and in prayer. Let us go now to Isaiah chapter 28. And so if you're listening to the tape, if this is a tape, I hope they're not messing the tape up. Of course, I messed the first part up because I had all kinds of white things hanging off my face. Can the church say amen? But now that I removed all of the foreign debris from my facade, and I have ceased to identify with the sufferings of Christ and have moved into a realm of imparting the word of God in such a way that I am no longer a distraction to the impartation of the Holy Spirit. Let us now go to the book of Isaiah chapter 28, and let us turn to verse number 9. This again is prophecy. Now there are some ministers, theologians, who do not agree with this. Doesn't make any difference what they agree with. They don't have any scripture to prove otherwise. And the scripture that we are going to teach certainly is following what I refer to and what we theologians refer to as a pattern of consistency. The pattern of consistency here is that this is, again, a prophecy, prophecy, which has to do with God speaking through the prophet Isaiah, having him leave on record in our canonicals. The term canonicals means our inspired writings, that which pertains to a future dispensation or period of truth. Are you listening to me? So now, this is a prophecy concerning the church dispensation. The term dispensation means period of truth. Verse number 9, let us read. Whom shall he teach knowledge? Hold it right there. The question is, whom shall he, God, the pronoun he refers to God, whom shall God teach knowledge, or whom shall the Lord teach knowledge? Read. And whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Now, if you're not going to preach doctrine, which is fine, you preach the gospel, then you must teach doctrine. So do not make the nonsensical statements that I'm not going to deal with doctrine, because what you're saying is that then you're going to abandon the apostolic ministry completely so that you can get numbers in your church. To say people don't want to hear doctrine, if they are God's people, they want to hear doctrine. If they have God's Holy Spirit, the Bible said that the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. And the term doctrine simply means teaching established to be taught. So if they are God's people, then they want to be taught. If they have God's Holy Spirit, then there is a desire to know. And this then would mean if you are God's preacher, then you will teach doctrine. You will preach the gospel, which contains the principles of the doctrine of Christ, and you will teach the apostolic doctrine as they did on the day of Pentecost and thereafter. After they preached the gospel from what we refer to as Psalms 16, Peter taking his text from the 16th Psalm, first division, thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thy Holy One to see corruption. Then he preached the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. And they that heard him were pricked in their hearts and said, men and brethren, what shall we do? And Peter commanded, or Peter instructed them, saying, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And they did repent, for they were granted repentance as a gift. And they were baptized in water in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And undoubtedly, they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit as you and I have. And as I quoted earlier, and we will read before the night is over, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. This is in your Bible in the book of Acts chapter 2 and verse number 42. So it is to some extent a degree of ignorance on the part of anyone blurting out these kinds of foolish things. And so we have to be careful. Turn to someone and say, we have to be careful what we say. So he is going to teach knowledge, and he is going to make those that are his children, this is who he's referring to, God is going to make those that are his children understand doctrine. Who is he going to do this from? Who are they? Them that are weaned from the milk. Please read it again. Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. This process of weaning, an old-fashioned example is when the mother was giving the child the first solid foods. Many of you in my television audience remember these days. The old-fashioned method was for the mother to take the meat and put it in her mouth first, chew it until it was thoroughly masticated with saliva. Then she would take it out of her mouth and put it in the mouth of the child. And though this sounds a bit unsanitary, I don't know of an instance where anyone has suffered any any child has suffered any degree